You are now listening to Beasts of the East with Ryan Morick, Scott Thompson, and Dean Roventini on WRPR 90.3 FM.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Far too kind.
Hello, fans of all ages. We are indeed the Beasts of the East. Ryan Morick, Scott Thompson, Dean Roventini with you on this Friday, September 9th, 2016. Right here on WRPR 90.3 FM, Wawa, Ramapo College Radio. Busy day today.
Busy?
We were busy.
I had one class.
You had one class. I had one class.
I got to sleep in, go to class at 2. It was a good Friday. Not bad Friday.
Not bad. It's not bad.
Yeah.
We're missing Scott, though.
Yeah, I don't know.
Scott's off today. Scott's off today. Right now, it's just me and Dean Roventini coming to you live from Ramapo College of New Jersey in Mahwah, New Jersey. And remember how that whole thing we said 5 days a week and all that?
Yeah.
And then Wednesday, Scott and I have a game.
Yeah.
Yesterday.
I would have done it. I didn't know my thing worked. I didn't know my key worked.
Well, it works.
Yeah, I know. I would have done it.
Everyone's works. All except right. For one person. Someone's does not work, and I have to get that fixed.
Oh, but yeah. Okay, yeah. So Wednesday, yeah, you guys had the game, and I didn't know my key worked. And then yesterday, what? Oh, you had
Yesterday, you had class.
I did a class, yeah, so I couldn't even make it anyway. And then you had that awesome
and then I had
dinner.
It was pretty cool, actually. Yeah? Tom Rinaldi's a good guy.
You meet, like, a lot of people, like, big people?
I thought it was actually, like, this whole big ESPN thing.
Yeah.
But it was actually just his book signing. You heard the story a million times about the guy in the red bandana on 9/11. And it's on ESPN, like, this time of year, every year.
Yeah.
The red bandana, the lacrosse player, he went and saved, like, a bunch of people. Unfortunately, he died.
Mm-hmm.
He wound up writing a book about it, and it was a book signing, and then we all went out to dinner after. And hopefully he can come on this show sometime soon because we chatted for a little bit.
Oh, that's awesome.
We talked a little bit about golf, so that was kind of cool.
Gave him the card.
Gave him the card.
Attaboy.
Gave him the business card. Had my number, email address, so we're all good.
Yeah.
And then afterwards, we went back to my uncle's house, and we saw the Yankees win their fifth in a row. Tyler Austin. Walk-off bomb, Oppo, 3-2, two outs. And just like that, we said it on Tuesday. A week or two ago, no one in their right mind, I mean, a little more than a week or two ago, maybe a month ago, right around the trade deadline, there was no one saying they had a chance to do it. No one said, watch out for the Yankees. They're going to be something special. If you're really sitting and saying that you had this feeling, that's just blind fandom. No one had this. The Yankees didn't have this feeling. Because if they didn't have the feeling, they wouldn't have traded all away. But right now, they're two games out. They still have how many games left on this homestand? They still have six more games left.
Yeah.
Tampa, three more games, and they beat Tampa last night.
Yeah.
And then the Dodgers come to town. Clayton Kershaw is pitching on Wednesday. We should. I'm trying to go to that game.
Want
to
go?
Let's go.
Yeah, right.
All right, let's go.
I have no class Wednesdays.
All right, we're going. That's simple.
All right, so Wednesday, ladies and gentlemen, not here.
Wednesday, no show.
I would love to see him.
Yeah, no. Think about it, because the Yankees, the AL East, plays the NL West once every 3 years, and then they flip-flop home field.
Yes.
So the next time we would be able to see Kershaw, if he's even on the Dodgers, is for another 6 years from now. All right, we're going on Wednesday.
Yeah.
Simple as that. So we talked about it on Tuesday. We don't want to sound like broken records, but the Yankees are a big topic. They're two games out when 10 days ago they were 4.5 games out, and there was really – no hope for this team at all. And all of a sudden, there's a lot of hope surrounding the Bronx now. And the Baby Bombers are doing their job. Tyler Austin has been hitting well as of late. Aaron Judge saw the ball well last night. Gary Sanchez, you already know what he's been doing. Sure, he hasn't hit a home run in quite some time, but he's still doing the job.
Yeah, that's fine.
Their only bugaboo is that they have a tough schedule. Every team that they're playing has a better record than them, other than Tampa. But the good thing about that is that those teams with the better records, again, aside from L.A., are ahead of the Yankees. So comparing and contrasting a month ago to today, 1 month ago, the white flag was being waved around. Today, as insane as this might sound, the Yankees could have a postseason spot the earliest tomorrow night.
That's true. You're right about that. I mean, it's like you said, it's crazy to think, because you thought, you know, when all those trades happened and you're bringing up all these young guys, that this isn't a playoff contending team. Obviously, because, you know, you have a bunch of young guys and you just sold the big pieces away, you know, your best bat and best, you know, your best arms. So it's crazy to see. And I think these guys, the whole clubhouse is like kind of, I think, re-energized. You see, like, I was watching the, I didn't watch it live, but I was watching the video of it because I had to see it, obviously. And the biggest surprise I saw was just like the emotion on Teixeira. Like, hugging Austin. Yeah. Super
happy. Well, he knows
happy.
He only has 20 games left.
I know. It's just like, you know, it's like these guys, everyone in the clubhouse is all in for the future. Even though like, guy like Teixeira, who won't be here next year, he's happy that there is a guy like Tyler Austin and guys like Gary Sanchez, Aaron Judge, etc., who are going to who bring a bright spot for the Yankees in the upcoming years. So that's just awesome to see. But, like we said Tuesday, it's going to be difficult, but there is a chance, and baseball is one of those sports where really anything can happen. So it's going to be exciting to watch, definitely.
Two games out with, I think they have 22 left. So if they want to get to 88 wins, which is usually, they won 87 last year and got the first wild card. That 88 might not be enough to get the first one, maybe the second one. If they have to get to 88 wins, they are... What is their record right now? The Yankees are 74-65. So to get to 88, they have to go 14 and what's 162 minus 88 off the top of your head?
I was watching the I don't know.
88 and 74, right? So they have to go 14-9. Yes. Which isn't a miraculous stretch, especially with the way they've been playing now. I mean, right now they're season high 9 games over.
You wouldn't think it's reasonable, but it's like you said, how they have been
14-9 is
not so bad.
It's not bad.
But I don't know, it is exciting.
And to get to 90, they would have to go 16-7. That is a little bit of a stretch. They have to play 9 over. They have to play 9 over for the rest of the year when they're finally 9 over now, which is a season high.
Mm-hmm.
88 games is pretty realistic. But they do have a tough schedule coming up. But again, this tough schedule, it's all against teams that they need to jump ahead. They have 6 more against Tampa,
mm-hmm.
4 more against Toronto, or 7 more against Toronto. Do they have because they have a 4-game series with them? It's Tampa, LA.
Don't they finish the year with them?
They finish the year home against Baltimore. Here, I got it. 3 more against the Rays. Well, 6 more against the Rays, 3 more this series, and then 1 during the 11-game road trip, which is going to be very difficult.
That is really going to be tough.
So right now it's 3 more against Tampa, and then 3 against the Dodgers, then 4 at Boston, their only off day of the year, of the rest of the year coming after that, 3 in Tampa, 4 in Toronto, 3 home against Boston, 3 home against Baltimore. So 6 more games of this homestand coming up. And by the way, they're 5-2 on this homestand. They started this homestand 0-2.
Yeah.
So they've won their last 5. Sweeping Toronto, which is without a doubt a much better team than them. And that's with Jose Bautista not playing well. Imagine where they would be right now if Bautista was playing like he did last year.
Oh.
He's batting .225 right now, and he doesn't even have 20 home runs.
Yeah, I don't even think it would be a race, to be honest.
So 11-game road trip, and then they end on a 6-game homestand. Now, you said the clubhouse is energized.
Yeah, definitely.
They have one of the best records, if not, I think they have the best record in the American League since the All-Star break. But let's look at their record from the day. That's what I heard. I don't know how true that is.
It could be a top one, definitely. But I feel like the Rangers haven't slipped, and I feel like they continue to dominate. So, and even the Royals bounced back from a slow start.
Yep. But you said that the clubhouse was energized.
Yes, I did.
And distractions have been a thing amongst the Yankees, and that big distraction was A-Rod. Look at what this team has done since A-Rod left. First of all, the series before A-Rod left, which is at Boston, they took 2 out of 3 against them.
Mm-hmm.
They took 2 out of 3 against Tampa. They lost the series against Toronto following that. They beat the Angels 2 out of 3. They beat the Mariners 2 out of 3. They beat the Orioles 2 out of 3. They beat the Royals 2 out of 3. They lost 2 out of 3 to Baltimore. They swept Toronto. So they've won all but one series. All but two series.
Two, yeah. That's awesome.
Could that be that A-Rod was a big distraction for them? Especially in that – because we saw in July, I mean, April was a down month.
Yeah.
May, they shot up a little bit. June, they always crept back up a little bit. And we could talk about this later. They're in this position right now because they started the year 8-16. Simple as that. If they keep this pace from May 6th or so on, if they kept that pace from the beginning of the year, they would be ahead. I remember at one point, this was about a week and a half ago, from May 3rd on, they had the second best record. They had a better record from that date than Boston and Baltimore. Only team with a better record was Toronto. So May was a solid month. June was a solid month. July, that's when they started to fall off a little bit. They were 8-8 in their first 16 games after the wild card and all the distraction with A-Rod. And to share it too, but A-Rod got more of it because he wasn't playing and Girardi was getting asked so many questions about it. And it got to the point where Girardi got really upset. And then he said, A-Rod's going to play. And then he didn't play. And then he wound up playing third for one batter. It was such a big circus that it wound up being such a distraction. And I hate to say it, but it's very possible that once A-Rod left, that's why this team is playing well.
You're definitely – yeah, I mean, you can say that, definitely. And I don't think it's in the sense of – kind of like it wasn't like he was a cancer to the clubhouse. And this, I think it was in the sense of, well, this is a big guy. This is, you know, Alex Rodriguez we're talking about. He's supposed to produce for us, but he's not even in the field. He's not even in the lineup all the time. And when he is in the line, he's not being Alex Rodriguez. So it's kind of more pressure for guys, especially like Teixeira. Well, when Beltran was there, even guys like Didi and Starlin come back, that's a lot more pressure to pick up the slack that he isn't producing. Now you kind of, when he is gone, and you kind of have that feeling where everyone's sold, and you have these young guys who are playing to have a roster spot come next year to be a cement name into the roster, you know, during spring training and in the beginning of the year. I think you're right. It was probably a big distraction, but I don't think it was in the sense of he's a terrible guy and he's ruining this whole thing. It's just he's not the A-Rod that we expect him to be, and you know, obviously it led up to him being bye-bye.
And what stinks for the Yankees is that they made the postseason last year because A-Rod hit 33 home runs and Teixeira hit 31 home runs and was on pace for about 40-something before he got injured. And then you look into this year saying the Yankees have a very good postseason chance despite the fact that Baltimore improved and Boston improved and Toronto's Toronto. You still looked at this team in March and April and you said if those two can play, they have a very good shot. But without them, it's not a very good team. And we saw that firsthand. A-Rod and Teixeira batting below 200 for the very good majority of the year.
Yeah.
Each of them with less than 10 home runs, I believe. We saw that this team did not have a lot of talent outside of that. And the two exceptions, the bullpen before the trade deadline, Didi Gregorius and Carlos Beltran. And Carlos Beltran got traded. And I can't help but think, where would this team be without if Carlos Beltran never got traded? But I think the answer to that is they would probably be where they are right now. If not, they would have a worse record. Because if Beltran doesn't get traded, Gary Sanchez never comes up. It's that simple. Because they have the outfield set. They have Gardner, Ellsbury, and Aaron Hicks. Assuming Aaron Hicks got injured, so maybe they would have wound up bringing up Sanchez. But
wait, Sanchez or Judge?
Sanchez.
But Sanchez catches. Oh, because the DH.
He's been DHing.
Okay. All right, yeah. All right, makes sense. Sorry.
So
go ahead.
And Carlos Beltran never had a stretch like Gary Sanchez did. Gary Sanchez, we said on Tuesday, he has the highest WAR out of American League rookies.
Yeah. Yeah.
So this team, without that Beltran trade, even though he was their best player by far, they might have a worse record than they do right now because of how good Gary Sanchez has been. If Beltran wasn't on this team, they might not bring up Sanchez, and he doesn't DH. McCann probably catches a lot more. They might not even – maybe Judge and Austin still come up, and they would have been September call-ups anyway. But these trades force these guys in, and it's worked out for them. And by the way, since – A-Rod's including A-Rod's last game on April 12th, the Yankees are 16-9 since that stretch. So they've won 16 of their last 25 games. 201-825-1234 is the phone number. That's 201-825-1234. More Yankees talk coming up, but we want to get into some football talk as well. We're going to tell you who we want you to play in fantasy, who we want you to sit in fantasy for Fantasy Football Fridays. Woo. We're going to also talk a little bit more about Colin Kaepernick, and we're going to talk about the NFL as a whole because they're hypocrites, and you'll find out why in just a couple of minutes. So don't go anywhere. It's the Beast of the East right here on WRPR 90.3 FM Ramapo College Radio. Beast of the East.
Hi, this is Ozzy Osbourne. For many years, you know I've had a drink problem, and I'm trying to battle that problem every single day. But one thing I don't do, I don't drive my car when I'm drinking. I get someone to drive me. Do not drink and drive. It's the stupidest thing. If you drink, just don't drive. Not only are you going to hurt yourself, you may hurt some other person, and you wouldn't want that on your conscience, would you?
A public service announcement brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
I'm a champion, realize Shaq's mechanism.
Hi, Shaquille O'Neal for Rad. This is not your normal PSA. Don't be stupid. Don't drink and drive. If you're going to go out and have a good time, it's fine. But designate a driver to drive home. Let's stop the madness. Don't drink and drive.
A public service announcement brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
Beast of the East! Ryan Morick, no Scott Thompson, Dean Rovatini. Don't worry about it. We're all good. Two beasts is all you need.
Wow, that was nice.
Thank you. Appreciate that. So.
Wait, who was that?
What?
Is that Jake Miller?
Yeah.
That's funny.
Melissa and I, I actually, because, you know.
You're Ryan?
Yeah. Okay. He just came out with a new EP, which is like a mini version of an album, but not quite yet a mixtape.
Okay.
He just came out with one, and he's having a release party at Highline. You know Highline.
Highline?
Ballroom. Highline Ballroom.
Oh.
In the city.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
And he's having a release party there, and we bought tickets. I bought tickets.
Nice. When is it?
October 10th.
That's cool. Have you ever been to one?
A release party?
Yeah.
No. I don't know what it entails. I have no idea.
It's like a concert?
I don't know. He
just plays the whole thing.
I have no idea.
All right. I mean, hey, it sounds cool. It sounds like a good time. City's always nice.
Yeah.
Debatable. Okay. All right. Sorry.
So.
Not on St. Patty's Day.
Not on St. Patty's Day. I don't like the city.
All right. So what's up?
So. Let's get into some fantasy football.
Yay. All
right, fantasy football's so back.
It's so back. I love it.
Every year, I'm not mentally prepared at all until the first day, and then I'm all good.
What do you mean? Like,
I feel like I do my drafts, and then after the drafts, I just count down for the day, and I'm like, what am I... I don't know what to do with my hands type of thing. Like, it's one of those attitudes. And then football comes back on. And then,
see, because I'm always in Rob Abdul's league. So Rob,
Out Rob.
Yeah, shout out Rob. He'll tell me, all right, because he does the random things like, all right, you got this pick. So I hop on NFL.com, I do my mock drafts, just get the loose, you know, be like, all right, I'll be ready. Come draft time, I'm shaking, don't know what to do, freezing, like getting so sick. But this year, I feel confident in my team. I like my team, so. Hopefully this is a good year. I always start off the season terrible. Like, I always make the worst decision possible. Like, and then I look back on it and I go, well, why didn't I just start him? Why didn't I? It doesn't make sense. But I feel confident this year. I'm ready to go.
What do you want to do first? Play him or sit him?
Well, I don't know. You know what? Let's go with, you know, let's get people right to it. Let's play him.
Let's play him.
Know who to play.
Let's play him. You know what? You know who I'm really banking on this week?
Who?
Allen Hurns.
Oh, yeah?
Jacksonville Jaguars. He's our second receiver, but yesterday, me and my dad and my brother, we have a league, and we had to make a decision. Do we sit Kelvin Benjamin, or do we play him?
Yes.
And we wound up sitting him for Allen Hurns. So far, it's not that great of a move, but
Kelvin
Benjamin. I'm gonna bank on a number two receiver, but with not saying that Cam Newton's not a great quarterback, but Blake Bortles has been a touchdown machine. He throws the ball a lot.
Mm-hmm.
We saw Allen Robinson got 14 touchdowns last year. Allen Hurns has the potential to be 6, 7, 8 plus touchdowns. And opening week at home against Green Bay, Green Bay has never had a very good defense. I'm liking Allen Hurns this week. If you have him, definitely play him. That is, if you're thinking about sitting someone. If you have guys like Antonio and AJ, then play him because you're questioning playing someone else.
Yeah.
I like Allen Hurns this week a lot. He's my sleeper for the week.
My play him of the week is D'Angelo Williams from the Steelers. Obviously, Le'Veon Bell will have a 3-game suspension. And he is the starting running back for him and did a fantastic job when Bell was out last year. So look for him to have big numbers for the Steelers. I believe they are going against the Redskins, who, yes, they get Josh Norman, but this, we're talking about the running game right now, and that is for D'Angelo Williams. I have him on my team, and I actually am starting him. I drafted him late, starting him over Danny Woodhead, so I'm looking forward to.
You're
him.
Starting D'Angelo over Danny Woodhead.
Yes, I am.
Who do they play? Kansas City. Never mind. Good idea.
Yeah, and plus they're tricky too. San Diego's tricky because they have Melvin Gordon as well. That's someone else. Oh, you want to go sit him?
Real quick about D'Angelo Williams.
Go ahead.
He might be their backup. I mean, not now because Le'Veon suspended.
Yeah.
And when Le'Veon comes back, D'Angelo does nothing. But last year, I picked Le'Veon at 4 because he had a 2-game suspension. I figured that was worth it. And I picked D'Angelo Williams. D'Angelo Williams, those 2 weeks, he was the best running back scorer in standard leagues.
Yeah.
D'Angelo Williams, when you play him, when Le'Veon is out, you have a top 5 running back right there.
Yeah, definitely.
So you might
Without a doubt.
Is Le'Veon gone? Sure. But D'Angelo Williams is a top 5 back when he's in there.
Top five. All right, so who do you have for do you have another plan? You have another sleeper in your sense, or do you have?
I do have another sleeper, not as much as Allen Hurns, but I like Marcus Wheaton a lot, just for the season in general. I love Wheaton.
Yeah.
Think about it. He's the number 2 option on a great offense. You look at what Martavis Bryant did last year. And the year before that, Martavis is a touchdown machine. Marcus Wheaton's going to be the same exact thing.
Definitely a great flex.
The same exact thing.
Yeah, definitely.
My sit-em. I'm trying to look at this one. My sit-em's going to be Matt Forte.
Matt Forte? Why?
Matt Forte. I mean, I understand that he's probably going to be someone's RB1 or RB2 if he's not very good. If he's not your RB1 or RB2, then I think you have to sit him. I do like the Jets this week at Cincinnati. I do. I'm going to pick the Jets to win this weekend, and I understand that Cincinnati is a better team. I understand that the Jets have not really made too much improvements outside of Forte, and they re-signed Fitzpatrick and whatever. And I do have the Jets winning this week because I just think the home crowd is going to be electric. Playing at home, New York City, on the 15th anniversary of 9/11, I just think it's going to be too much for Cincinnati to handle. I think the crowd is going to be in rare form on Sunday. But we know that Cincinnati D, and I hate to sound like I'm not going to analyze about it too much because we just know how Cincinnati's defense is. And you know what? I've come to realize now I like Forte in general in fantasy and especially in PPR. If you have PPR, go ahead and play him. But if you are in a standard league and you have Matt Forte, you should definitely think about sitting him because he's not their third. They're going to give it to Bilal Powell on third down. Essentially, Matt Forte, he might not even be their goal line guy. He's not going to score a lot.
Yeah.
Non-PPR leagues, Matt Forte is not going to get the job done, especially this week. PPR leagues, different story. But non-PPR league, I would sit Matt Forte.
My sit-em is a combo on the same team. Julian Edelman and Martellus Bennett.
They're playing Arizona?
Yes, they are. Arizona's a tough defense. This is Garoppolo's first start for the Patriots. So I believe that that's too shaky enough, especially with that defense. I think the only person that will be effective for the Patriots will be Gronk because it's really impossible to
stop
him.
I'm hearing
that
Gronk is out.
He is questionable? I got the update before.
I heard he's out.
No, really?
That's what I'm hearing.
I may have to switch that, though.
We'll let you know. Reports are saying that Gronk is out. NFL tweeted Gronkowski is not expected to play.
Okay, then I will change that to this. Julian Edelman, sit him. Martellus Bennett, I say you go ahead. Because those corners on Arizona are incredible. And Edelman, I don't think, is that great of a wide receiver. He's a good wide receiver. He's not a great wide receiver where he can blow out that secondary. So
especially with Garoppolo as your quarterback.
Yeah, especially that. So that is my sit him for the week.
Fantasy Football Fridays, best of luck in your respective leagues. Let's stay on football because Christmas morning is on Sunday. Giants kicking off at 4:25 at Dallas. Jets are kicking off at 1 o'clock p.m. at Cincinnati. Who has the better chance to make the playoffs, the Giants or the Jets? I am going to go Giants because the Jets' schedule is just very, very, very hard. And on top of that, I really like what the Giants did. I think that the Giants already have a top 10, definitely, offense last year. They had 6th most scoring, 8th most yards, so averaged about, we'll say, a top 8 offense. And last year, if they don't have they literally had one of the worst defenses of all time. Literally, one of the worst defenses of all time. That's not really an exaggeration. I really like what they did. I really think that front four is going to be scary. The linebacker core is still obviously their biggest question mark, and that's why I'm very afraid for this weekend because the Giants have always had trouble against mobile quarterbacks, and that is what Dak Prescott is. And if Prescott does get by that line, he's going to get by those linebackers. And Jason Witten, too.
Always has good games against the Giants.
Exactly. They're going to target those linebackers. I mean, remember last year, Awani Unga? He led the team in tackles that game because all they did was just force it down their throats. They forced it to the linebacker core, so that is still a question mark. But I really like their secondary now, their safeties. That's a big question mark. I think this year they'll struggle, but in a couple of years, if they stay consistent and they stay with the same group of safeties, I think Landon Collins will eventually
be pretty good. He'll get there. Yeah,
he will get there. I just think they're young and they're not experienced enough, but they have solid corners. They have Rodgers, Camardi, Eli Apple. Everyone's saying good things about him. They got Janoris Jenkins. Big move with Damon Harrison. Now they have a big wall in the middle.
Yeah.
I really like this team this year, and I like the fact that they're only playing 7 away games because they play L.A. in England. That you just have to assume that the better team, which is the Giants, is going to win that game. So you have 8 home games, 7 away games. That's a big deal. And, again, the Jets' schedule is really, really hard.
Yeah, the Jets do have a tough schedule, but if you look at it like the other way, the Giants did improve. But so the Jets, you know, Chris Ivey did a fantastic job in the beginning of the year. But Matt Forte is a seasoned veteran. He's a threat for passing and even rushing. So that's good for them on the offensive side. They signed back Fitzpatrick, which was very good because I don't think they would have been anywhere with Geno Smith. And then, but you got to look at it, the division. The Bills are a good team. You know,
Bills are a good team.
They especially come division games. We've seen that last year.
I think both the Giants and Jets should go 4-2 in their division. I think the Giants should sweep Philly. I think the Jets should sweep Miami, and they split against everyone else.
Yeah, exactly. I think the Jets. Did the Jets miss Brady?
No.
They get Brady, right?
They have Brady for both games.
Yeah, right. So, I
because it's week 12 and week 16. So
that's tough. And the Jets. I mean, it's Tom Brady. You're still looking at too. So to win that division past them, hopefully this suspension can give them enough edge to make the playoffs. But you look at the Giants division, and now you got, you know, the Cowboys with no Romo again. We don't know what Dak Prescott can do. The Phillies just. I mean, Philly. and then Washington is a big question mark, too, because, I mean, they won the division last year, which was...
Still not sold on them, though.
No, I'm not, but they did win it. You got to give them credit there. But I think that the Giants, who have the weaker division, a weaker schedule, but they improved significantly. So I'm going to give it to the Giants, too. And it helps that I'm a Giant fan, so...
Jets or Giants schedule first, to go over the records.
What do you got right in front of you?
I got Jets.
All right, then let's Jets.
Week one, home against the Bengals. I'm going a win. I think the Bengals are better. But, again, I think home field, very special day that day, especially being in New York.
And Jets fans are – yeah, especially that. You're right about there.
You hate
and
to say it, but it's going to play a factor.
Oh, definitely. And the Jets fans are nuts. You know, they're pretty crazy. And I think I can give the edge to them because – I don't know what the Bengals are going to come out with because that was a disappointing end of the year they had. So I'll give it to the Jets, too.
At the Bills, I'll give them a loss.
Think so?
I just think they're going to split against Buffalo. That's
okay. Yeah, all right. To be honest, it's a toss-up for me. I can agree with them winning.
Yep.
I can see them losing. I'm going to give them the win just because.
At KC, I give them a loss.
I definitely give them a loss. Yeah,
home against the Seahawks, I'm going to give them a loss too.
Ditto.
At Steelers, loss.
That's tough.
At Arizona, they can realistically start 0-6.
The funny thing is, realistically, they really could. That is scary, man. Steelers and then Cardinals at Arizona.
That's five teams that made the playoffs last year.
Oh my goodness.
Five teams that made the playoffs last
year.
That
is rough. I'm so happy I'm a Giant fan right now.
Right.
Against, but that is tough.
Home against Ravens, that's a win.
Win.
At Cleveland, that's a win.
You can play that.
At Miami, that's a win. Home against LA, I'll give them the win there also.
I'll give them, definitely.
So I have them at 5-5. I have them at 5-5.
Okay. I think I have them at like 6-4 right now.
Yeah, something like that. I think they're going to split against the Patriots. So week 12, I'll give them the win there. Home against Indy. Wow, that's going to be a good game.
That should be a good game. Hopefully, Andrew Luck finds his way again. That last year was, you know, with all injuries and everything, wasn't that great. So,
The Colts' offensive line's really bad, though, and I think that's going to play a really big factor.
Yeah.
I'll give the Jets the win on that one.
I don't know. That's really a toss-up. I think it's really going to – you can tell that game by week three of how – Luck is playing. Because I think Luck can literally light up
if
that secondary.
If Luck is playing well, you'll know.
Yeah, so that's
right now
that's
it's a toss-up.
That's a toss-up for me.
I'll give the Jets the win on that. At San Fran, I'll give them another win.
Yeah, definitely.
Home against Miami, I'll give them that win.
Yeah.
And then let's give them a loss.
A loss at, in New England.
And then they'll split with Buffalo. So what is that? Splitting with New England, splitting with Buffalo, winning both against Miami. So that's 4-2. And then I have them 5-2, 5-3, 5-4, 5-5, 6-5, 7-5, 8-5, 9-5, 10-5. Did I miss something? I think I have them 10-6.
Hey.
And 10-6 is going to be really difficult to get for this team.
Yeah, it is. Especially with that schedule, man. Because
they can realistically start 0-6. They can realistically get swept by the Pats and Buffalo. They could. They can.
You're right. You're totally right. And realistically, I mean, they can have one of those games like last year where
Marshall
they lose. I mean, they could lose to Miami. You never know. Division games are completely different.
Yeah.
It's insane to say, but like it really, they are. It's like it's just a whole different type of atmosphere. So you never know.
Those first 6 weeks are rough. And then it gets easy. Then they're home against Baltimore, at Cleveland, at Miami, home against the Rams. Those four should all be wins.
Yeah, but I don't think they can be a wild card team. I think if they have to win the division. Because there are good teams in the AFC.
There are.
Very good teams. So,
Baltimore is a good team, too.
Yeah.
Baltimore had a bad record last year, but they lost their first 9 games by less than a touchdown every game.
Yeah, I know. It's kind of very disappointing here.
Now let's take a look at the Giants'
G-Man
schedule. Let me pull that up. At Dallas week one, I'm going to say that, well, first of all, I'm going to go with division. I'm going to say they go 4-2 in the division. Split Dallas, split Washington, and hopefully.
I think
they're really
Dallas.
Bad at Philly. They always play bad at Philly.
You're right.
but they're really bad. Like, Philly is really bad.
No, but like I said before, division games are completely different. And but you're right. You know what? To be honest, I think
I'll say 3-3 for the Giants in the division because they always play. Actually, I'm going 4-2. 4-2. Philly's really bad. At Cowboys, I'll give them a loss.
You think they're going to start the season with a loss?
Yes.
All right.
Home against the Saints, I'll give them a win.
All right.
Home against the Redskins, I'll give them that split, so 2-1. At Minnesota, I'll give them a loss.
I'll give them a win.
At Green Bay.
I lost. Sorry.
That's tough.
Dude, that's one of the hardest places to play. At least it's what, October? At least
Giants
it's, at least it's October.
Giants
that is true.
That doesn't even play into my decision right now. I just think that...
Well, where it is?
The fact that they are historically good in Green Bay, the last couple of years, rather. I think that Green Bay's defense is really bad. Giants' defense improved.
Yeah, but it's Aaron Rodgers. And you got Jordy Nelson Bells. Jordy Nelson back, sorry.
We'll give the Packers the win. Home against Baltimore, I'll give them the win.
Yeah, I can give them a win.
At the Rams, but that's in L.A., I'll give them the win there.
Agreed.
Home against the Eagles, I'll give them the win.
Mm-hmm.
Home against the Bengals. Oh, they have 3 home games in a row. That's important. Home against the Bengals, though, I'm going to give them the loss.
They beat Bears.
They beat the Bears. They beat the Browns away.
Yep.
They lose to the Steelers. They beat the Cowboys. They beat Detroit.
That's my birthday. I want to go.
December 18th.
I want to go.
We're thinking about
Dad,
traveling to Pittsburgh for Brandon's birthday.
I heard that. Yo, my friends might do that too.
That'd be pretty cool.
I know, but like, I want to go for my birthday.
So, let's see. It's the same story with the Giants every year. They play up or down to the level of their opponent. They can go 0-16. They can go 16-0. They can go 10-6. They can go 6-10. But we'll see. Games aren't played on paper. They're played on the gridiron, and it all starts on Sunday for New York football.
That was tough.
We'll get into some more Colin Kaepernick, and like we said before, the NFL is hypocritical. I'll get into a small little segue. Cam Newton got beat up yesterday, and the NFL did not act upon it whatsoever. We'll talk about it right here on the Beast of the East on WRPR 90.3 FM.
Hey, parents of children with asthma, here's another hit from the Breathe Easies. Don't smoke in the house. Don't smoke in the house. Don't smoke around the kids in the house. Don't smoke in the car. Don't smoke in the house. Don't break my heart. Preventing asthma attacks can be as simple as making your home and car smoke-free zones. For more Breathe Easy tips to help stop asthma attacks, go to noattacks.org. Brought to you by the EPA and the Ad Council.
Hey, this is Flea from the Red Hot Chili Peppers for Rad. I'm here to remind you that drunk drivers are still a major killer of young adults in this country. So always choose a designated driver, and remember, music lives, you should too. Getting blown in the state of Mississippi.
Papa was a copper and a mama was a hippie. A public service message brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, Rad, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
Hi, this is Ozzy Osbourne. For many years, you know I've had a drink problem, and I'm trying to battle that problem every single day. But one thing I don't do, I don't drive my car when I'm drinking. I get someone to drive me. Do not drink and drive. It's the stupidest thing. If you drink, just don't drive. Not only are you going to hurt yourself, you may hurt some other person, and you wouldn't want that on your conscience, would you?
A public service announcement brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
A new world for us two, with you in the middle.
One more segment right here on Beasts of the East. Ryan Moore, Dean Rovatini with you on WRPR 90.3 FM, Mahwah, Ramapo College Radio. So, what do I want to talk about first?
I thought you want to talk, NFL-wise?
Yes, I'm debating. We'll stay with Kaepernick. So,
Kaepernick!
We mentioned it before. Sunday is the 15th anniversary of 9/11, something that directly or indirectly affects us all one way or another. And we all know what's been happening with Colin Kaepernick and his kneeling during the national anthem. And the first football Sunday falls on 9/11. And there's been a lot of talk about, I mean, the 49ers play on Monday, the 12th, which obviously is not the 11th. But we don't know if, I haven't heard anything yet, but if there will be a commemoration for the victims in 9/11 on the 12th. If there is, and he kneels or sits or whatever, and I think all three of us said it on Tuesday, he has the right, whether we like it or not, I think we're all in agreement that we don't like it and we disagree with it, but we understand why he's doing it and we understand that he is allowed to do it. And the Broncos said it last night with their linebacker, Brandon Marshall. They would rather everyone stand, but they understand it's a personal choice.
Yeah.
But I think if you do that on Monday, or if anyone does it on Sunday, because people on the Seahawks did it, and
Brandon Marshall on the Broncos did it.
And again, he's not playing on the 11th, obviously, because he played last night.
Yeah. Just saying.
But I think more and more people are going to do this, and Sunday is the 15th anniversary of September 11th. And I think you lose me. And I understand I had family members in 9/11, and unfortunately I had to lose one. And this isn't coming from someone who lost someone in 9/11. This is just coming from someone who loves the country. You lose me if you kneel or sit on the anniversary of 9/11. And Dean, before we hear from you, let's go to the phone lines really quickly for our first caller on Beast of the East on WRPR. Who is this and where are you calling from?
Hello, hello.
Hey, what's going on?
Hold on, let me get my mother on the phone. She loves you guys, and it would mean a lot to her if she could talk to you guys.
Well, what's your name?
Hold on, let me get my mom.
All right.
Hello?
Hello, who is this?
Hello, boys. Oh, my goodness, I'm such a fan. I'm such a fan.
Is this your mother, Dean?
No.
No. I wish I was your mother's, because I'd come down to that studio and I'd pinch your cheek.
How sweet.
I love you guys.
How sweet.
And your silly songs that you play all the time. It's wonderful.
Thank you very much. We appreciate that.
I mean, you boys, you do your studying and you do your schoolwork and then you do your radio. You do it all.
We try our hardest.
You're like Renaissance men.
Thank you very much. We appreciate kind words.
Well, I don't want to take up too much of your time, but just keep up the good work. You're wonderful boys.
Thank you very much. We appreciate the kind words. I thought we were going to get an opinion, but you know what? That just made my day.
That was awesome.
That made my day. Now, going back to Kaepernick and the whole 9/11 scenario, that's where you lose me. If you want to kneel and protest against the country, and I said on Tuesday that's hypocritical in itself, fine. Do whatever you want. But you want to go, and it's not even going against it. And there wouldn't be a protest that, what would be that protest anyway?
No, exactly. I think it would be two different kind of things, because the national anthem or whatever, when plays for the, you know, the pledge, you kneel. Yeah, you want to protest against your country and what you don't believe in, whatever. But if this, we're talking about like 9/11 commemoration, that's a tragedy. You know, that's something that happened, and like you said, indirectly or directly affected all of us.
We have 3,000 flags out on the Grove right now. At
yeah, it's not, and you can't, how can you, you can't protest against that. It's something that happened, and it's not, I mean, whatever you want to believe or not, it's not something what our own country did, you know? So,
that's a whole, well, that's a whole different argument.
But you, like, you, it's some, not something that you can protest against, and if you do sit and you want to be, if you're disrespectful for it, that's where it changes the game, and you're just, I got more words for you that I can't say on a radio, you know. So I really don't, like I said, I like to think the best out of some people, out of everyone really. I don't think they're gonna do that. If there is gonna be a video, a moment of silence, I don't think anyone's gonna be sitting. Everyone's gonna be,
I sure hope not.
I sure hope not too. But
you said it. That's where the line is.
There's a difference.
Drawn.
There's
one thing between protesting against how your race is treated, and again, what would be the protest? There would be no protest for it. That is just the fact that we all agree that it's disrespectful anyway. That is just being disrespectful. Oh, yeah. For no reason. There's no protest against that. That's just... that's either blind... I don't know what you would want to call it. And you said it before. You have the idiotic conspiracy theory. That's all I'm going to say about it. Idiotic conspiracy theories. But again, it's not even the right protest. And that's where the line is drawn. And now let's go. I'm trying to go segue into this. The line was drawn last night also with the Panthers and Broncos game, and not about 9/11, but the fact that Cam Newton got drilled in the head over and over and over again. Everyone saw that fourth quarter play where the roughing the passer. Everyone saw that play because that was fourth quarter, 30 seconds left. That was on it was on second down, I think. That's the play that everyone saw. And Cam Newton looked like he had no idea where he was. And he didn't go through any sort of concussion protocol. That is where the NFL shows how hypocritical it is. They've been saying nonstop over the last, what, 3 or 4 years, player safety is the thing most important to us. We want the kids to be safe and make sure that they're playing a safe sport and watching a safe sport and having fun with a safe sport. And that proved right there that you care more about the ratings, the money, the moment, than player safety. Now, this might anger a lot of people. Can you blame them for wanting the money and the business and the ratings and the eyeballs? No. I know that's tough to hear, but at the end of the day, the NFL is a business. But you can't say that... You just can't go over and over saying that player safety is the most important thing and not have arguably the face of the NFL. And that's the thing, too. People are saying if it were Brady, if it were Rodgers, it would have been. No, it wouldn't have, because the NFL loves Cam Newton.
Yeah.
The NFL loves what he brings. Look at how many kids are attracted to Cam Newton and football.
Yeah.
Because of all of last year and his dabs and his touchdown dances. The NFL doesn't hate Cam Newton. If anything, the NFL loves Cam Newton. So don't compare that to, oh, if that were Brady and Carson Palmer and this and that, then it would have been, if anything, less. But again, the NFL, we know their true colors, but last night was bad. Last night was bad. It was it was a smack in the face.
You're going based off of, you said it is a business. And I think the NFL is the worst in sports with how, because obviously every sport is a business, you know, but the NFL is like the, is the right word to say, dirtiest? I don't know, but they are the business. But it's, I don't get how you can like look past trying to improve player safety, because all you have to do is do that. So make sure you have those guys like your Tom Brady's and your Cam Newton's, guys who attract other people to the sport. If you make them safe, your business will stay stay up or even rise. And then, you know, you worry about their safety. And if they do get hurt, there's another guy coming. And are they the same as these other top guys? No. Well, that's on you, NFL, because you aren't making this game safe for them. They're getting, like you said, like Cam Newton got hit in the head a bunch of times last night. That's not good. Like, there's long-term effects on that, and we've seen it. There is results of it, and it's something that's got to be dealt with now.
And there are people who are saying that Cam Newton is 6'4", he's 250, he's the size of a linebacker, he's going to get hit by like a linebacker. Or running. If he runs around like a running back and a wide receiver, he's going to get hit like one. So what's the proper way to hit a running back and wide receiver? In the head? With your own? That's still illegal, no matter who the player is. You're not allowed to leave with the helmet, and they deliberately did that. And Cam Newton looked dazed. He looked like he had no idea where he was. And the NFL wants to look at video and say there was no reason to go through concussion protocol. I saw a couple of reasons why he should have went through the protocol. The guy couldn't walk straight. And what was I just going to say? That penalty, the roughing the passer penalty, there was also intentional grounding, and those penalties offset. Intentional grounding and roughing the passer offset. So even if, let's say Cam Newton did go through concussion protocol, let's say he did not return to that game, and let's say he does have a concussion. Let's say that was the last play that he had. You're still not showing player safety because not reaching an imaginary line is apparently just as important than leading with your helmet and rocking some guy in the head. That's essentially what the NFL is saying with those offset penalties. It's garbage. It's garbage.
No, you're right. I was just going to say something. Oh, I was going to ask you, when they go through the concussion protocol, have to go inside, right?
I don't think so.
Do they or not?
I don't know.
Then why? Like, I don't get. It doesn't make sense of why just go through it then.
And what's concussion protocol? Flashlight to the eyes and okay, you're good. That's not like you have to go through.
Yeah. Well, if whatever it is, you get what they got to do is, even if there is a question of maybe this guy has a concussion or not, or he got hit in the head, do it. No matter what, it doesn't matter if you want to improve the safety of the players. You do it. Get it accessible on the sideline if it is or not. Like I said,
I'm almost positive that it is.
It should be. I mean, they should get it to be at least to be on the sidelines for each team. You pull them off for a play or two, or however long it takes. Hopefully it's a quick thing. I don't know. And then if he passes, you just put him back on the field. If he doesn't, you don't put him on the field because it's his safety, his well-being. You're gonna hurt a human being. Like, it's just ridiculous. Like how do they not think of these things? Like it's nuts. It's literally nuts.
And you're gonna get guys, like I said, you're gonna get the guys who say football is a contact sport. Deal with it. Okay, it's a contact sport. It's not it shouldn't be a lethal sport.
You're right. Yeah, you're
right. I joke about it I joke about it all the time that football needs to take helmets out of the game, and last night proved that. Yeah. Have you and I or anyone that we know, we've played pickup football, me and you, a million times.
Yeah.
Have we ever gotten a concussion?
No.
We're also half the size of the people in the NFL,
but regardless, the
helmet is used as a weapon.
Yeah.
And are they going to take helmets out of the game? No. And should they? I like to joke about it and say yes, but realistically, last night's a good reason why they should. But again, you can't say player safety is important and just act like nothing happened yesterday. You can't have two penalties offset. You can't look at video and say, okay, that was his concussion protocol, looking at a video. Roger Goodell has already been in a lot of trouble. This is the same guy who suspended Ray Rice for 2 games, saw the video, suspended him for more games, and went on national TV and said, what show was it? It was on Jon Stewart's, The Daily Show, right?
Daily Show?
He was the, yeah. This
false,
was
false shows.
And they showed a clip of an interview, and the lady interviewing said, did you really need to see a video of Ray Rice punching his girlfriend in the face to make another decision? And Goodell said, no. What we saw in the first video was disturbing in itself. I'm quoting him verbatim here. And he said, no, the first video was disgusting in itself, but once we saw the second video, we had to take action. So you did need to see the video to suspend him. And on top of that, remember the whole thing where they said he got emailed the video in April?
Yes, yes. Is there
The guy is a snake! The guy is a snake!
He's the worst. He's literally
He gets
the worst.
Booed. I hate to say, the NHL is poorly run. They had two lockouts in less than a decade. The NFL is not very far behind. They're
no,
not.
You're right. No, you're right. You're right.
And also, last year, they had the most concussions listed in the last 3 years. It went down 3 years in a row, and then it skyrocketed last year. So one of two things happened. Either A, just more concussions happened, not based on bad luck, or two, in the last 3 years, a lot of concussions went under the radar. And last night was not a good start to what's already a very hypocritical business.
He's got to do something. It's something that has to be dealt with now.
The hit should have warranted suspensions. Yeah. And
the NFL.
And these are the quarterbacks too.
Yeah. These are the prize guys.
Exactly.
I
understand defenders' thought processes. If you have a chance to hit a quarterback, you're going to hit a quarterback.
Yeah.
But do it legally.
Oh, of course. Yeah. But. Yep.
Weekend off. Are we going to get back here on Monday?
Yeah,
I think we're going to back.
Yeah.
I'm almost positive we'll be here on Monday.
Why wouldn't you? You got something?
There might be a game.
I'll be here.
I'm going to try.
I'll be here. I'll do it.
21st birthday special, baby!
That's right. Yeah, boy!
Oh.
All right.
Hopefully, it'll be a fun show, and hopefully, the Yankees will be in the wild card spot, and hopefully, the Giants take a W against Dallas, but we'll have to wait and see. Until then. It's not goodbye. It is see you later. So long. Take care. Have a great weekend. And we'll talk to you on Monday.
Yeah, it's just violent.